This video is sponsored by CuriosityStream.
I'm standing in front of the Arroyo Seco Parkway, the first real freeway built in the Western United States. It was built in 1940 and set up a wave of freeway construction in this region. And if I must say, it did so with a little bit of style, if a freeway can have style.
Today, freeways crisscross the region, bringing with it mobility, but also a whole lot of traffic. Freeway traffic has become an iconic part of Los Angeles, as much a part of its mythology as Hollywood stars and sandy beaches. I mean, the opening scene of a movie called La La Land is a song and dance number in freeway traffic. While it's difficult to have one clear measure of traffic, numerous studies have identified LA as having either the worst traffic in the US or among the worst.
How did LA traffic get so bad? Was it inevitable as LA grew into the second largest city in the United States? Or was it because of a series of deliberate policy decisions made at the state, local, and federal levels? This is a jam-packed video full of twists and turns, so buckle up and enjoy the ride. While I'm standing on one of the OG freeways, let's go back in time to 1940 when the Arroyo Seco Parkway was new.
The LA of that time was already huge. There were 1.5 million people living within the city limits and 3 million living within the region. The region's population tripled between 1920 and 1940. This was the transition period from the streetcar to the automobile. LA actually had the largest streetcar network of any city in the world during that period. I have a whole video on the LA streetcars if you're interested in that era specifically. Streetcar suburbs were tailor-made for the automobile, with straight streets and predominantly single-family homes. And because LA grew rapidly during that time, the entire region was covered in that neighborhood style. The car was a perfect fit for that land use.
But there was something missing. The car worked great in LA's neighborhoods, but it was difficult to get from one point in the region to anywhere else in the region. There just weren't enough thoroughfares in the metropolis. That's why the Arroyo Seco Parkway felt like a revelation at the time. It cut the travel time from Pasadena to downtown LA from 27 minutes to 12 minutes, all while making the drive more comfortable and enjoyable.
City planners at that time could barely contain their excitement about the idea of replicating the Arroyo Seco Parkway all across the region. They issued several plans that argued strongly in favor of freeways. This publication from the Los Angeles County Regional Planning Commission isn't even really a plan, it's more of a manifesto. There are entire pages that are essentially advertisements for freeways. Despite the enthusiasm of local planners, the initial freeway plan for LA, drafted in 1939, was nowhere near as extensive as today's network. The plan also included expansions to mass transit, such as grade-separated subways, either operating underground or in the new freeway medians. The freeways were designed to complement existing land use and foster new development according to the region's land use goals. It was still a freeway plan, though, of course. The plan called for over 600 miles of expressways in LA County in 15 years. But compared to the plans we're about to see, it's practically smart growth.
This early enthusiasm for freeways and cars, at least relative to other cities, came back to haunt LA. Yes, their early plans were multimodal and called for sensitivity for existing land uses, but they still also called for a lot of expressways. State and federal government officials built on this enthusiasm and took advantage, resulting in a larger freeway system than maybe other cities would have had.
In the 1940s, the state of California began to raise funds to finance freeway construction, including the 1939 LA plan. But the legislature put the state highway department in charge of building urban freeways. The state took control over half of LA's planned expressways and made them state highways. LA's proposed expressways all looked a lot like the Arroyo Seco Parkway, with speed limits of 45 miles per hour and alignments that followed natural features or made sense with existing land use. The state eliminated all plans for mass transit and designed the freeways to be the same as rural freeways: wide, fast, straight, and without consideration for adjacent uses. The 1956 Federal Aid Highway Act supercharged this transformation. For every dollar a state government dedicated to freeway construction, the federal government would contribute $9. It made little financial sense to build any freeways in the Arroyo Seco mold, and all of LA's planned expressways became state and interstate freeways built to the rural freeway model. Local planners essentially had no control over the design of new freeways.
The federal government wanted to connect cities and build a national network of freeways. That was the goal. The Federal Highway Act did not require state or federal governments to comply with local plans or even consult with local officials when designing the network. That's why you have an urban freeway network serving a city like LA. And in fact, most trips in the LA area stay in the LA area. It's not a good match of infrastructure to people.
So you might be thinking, LA has more freeways than any region in the US, and they were way overbuilt compared to what they had originally planned. Shouldn't that mean that they have less traffic since they spread out all those cars across so many lanes of freeways? This is where Los Angeles runs into the paradox of induced demand. This concept states the demand for transportation is elastic. If the cost of transportation is reduced, more people will travel. So if you build a new freeway or add lanes to a freeway, more people will take more trips. The result is a clogged freeway. That's why adding freeway capacity doesn't solve traffic, it just creates more. There isn't a finite number of travelers and trips. Every time you add capacity, you're also encouraging people to travel more. Vox has a really nice explainer video on this topic if you want to learn more.
So that's why LA traffic is so bad. But the title of this video has a double meaning, and this video isn't over yet. We talked about why LA is so congested, but I also want to talk about why LA traffic is so bad for people from an equity and environmental standpoint. Let's do this piece as a lightning round.
All those freeways generate pollution that's terrible for human health. People living near freeways are at an increased risk for asthma, heart attacks, dementia, and other illnesses. The city of Los Angeles recommends not building homes within 1,000 feet of freeways, but it still happens anyway. Stop-and-go traffic generates more emissions per mile than free-flowing traffic. Investing in alternative modes can reduce congestion and make car trips produce less carbon per mile. Cars generate the fewest emissions per mile at around 40 to 60 miles per hour, moving at a constant rate. Traffic noise can be detrimental to your health. People who live near freeway noise generate more of the body's stress hormone cortisol, sleep worse, and are at greater risk of stroke and diabetes. The longer people live near the noise, the higher the risks get. One study suggests that the average American wastes 54 hours per year stuck in traffic. LA commuters waste the most time, 119 hours, just under 5 days every year stuck in traffic. The freeways that carry all that traffic have decimated neighborhoods all over the country. Boyle Heights in LA really got demolished. It was a low-income neighborhood at the center of the Chicano community in LA. The 5, 10, 60, and 101 freeways now cross through it, and their construction displaced 15,000 residents and made the lives of existing residents much worse.
LA's traffic is bad in every meaning of the word bad. The city's a great example of what happens when you design for the car first from the beginning and don't design for mass transit at the same time. Now, I know this conclusion is hardly groundbreaking. I mean, by the 1970s, freeway construction slowed as protests developed around the construction of new freeways and political will evaporated. People began to realize the consequences of building all these freeways. But has LA changed since then? Have they been building all the mass transit they designed in the 1930s? For an update of how LA is dealing with this terrible traffic today, you can go check out a version of this video over on Nebula.
That content actually replaces this ad because there aren't any ads on Nebula. We're calling this bonus extended content Nebula Plus. You'll see a lot of that over there, and not just for me, all sorts of creators uploading Nebula Plus content.
Nebula is great, and it's made even better thanks to our partnership with CuriosityStream.
CuriosityStream has amazing documentaries, and their library keeps growing, so there's always something new to watch. This new documentary, Hot Roads, is perfect if you want to learn more about other extreme road situations outside the LA area. It takes you on a global tour of some of the most extreme and dangerous roads out there, from Siberia to the road to death in the Andes. It's worth a watch. We have a deal where if you sign up for CuriosityStream using the link below, you'll get Nebula for free. That's not a free trial, but free as long as you're a CuriosityStream member. And they're running a special deal where you can get your entire year for 26% off. That's less than $15 for a year of CuriosityStream and Nebula.
Signing up is a great way of supporting this channel as well as the dozens of other creators working to make Nebula a success. It's overall just a really good deal too. So go click on the link in the description and get 26% off.